turn to the book of Jude. Today, we begin a new series through this book. And so this book is often overlooked by many. And perhaps it's overlooked because of its brevity. I mean, after all, there's just 25 verses in this letter. But maybe it's overlooked because in this letter, there are some strange references that we find to some non-biblical Jewish literature that can be confusing. And so maybe that's the reason why some just choose to stay away from this book. But I would say that neglecting this book would be a huge mistake in our lives. Because Jude's call to earnestly contend for the faith is a call that must be heard and heeded by each and every one of us. In every generation, believers must contend for the truth of the gospel and resist all false teaching. And so preaching from the book of Jude gives us an opportunity to be encouraged by God's power to keep His people, while also allowing us to understand our responsibility to keep ourselves in the love of God. And so this book gives us great insight into how we're to respond to false teachers, as well as how we're to respond to those that are influenced by said false teachers. And so this morning we begin our journey by looking at the first two verses from this letter. The writer of this letter introduces himself with a very simple and insightful declaration. Look at verse number one. He says, Jude, a bondservant of Jesus Christ and brother of James. So we'll stop there. We'll pause to give some thought and to some consideration as to who is this particular Jude that is writing this letter. Perhaps it would help you to understand that in Hebrew, the name would be Judah. In Greek, the name is Judas. And so what we have here is a shortened form of either the word Judah or Judas. And so when we consider the possibilities of who it is that might be the author of this letter, I think there are only really three possibilities that exist, although not all possibilities have the same weight or strength. Some are weak in their argument. So let me give you those three possibilities, and I'll start with the weakest one first. So some would contend or think that this Jude was a leader in the early church of Jerusalem. In fact, in Acts chapter 15, two men were sent with Paul to Antioch, and in verse number 22 of Acts 15, it says, then it seemed good to the apostles and the elders with the whole church to choose men from among them to send to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. Judas, called Barsabbas, and Silas, leading men among the brethren. And so interesting, notice the surname of this Judas. The surname is Barsabbas. That might sound familiar to you, because back in Acts chapter 1, Joseph Barsabbas was mentioned as one of the two possible nominees to replace Judas Iscariot. And so when they cast the lots, it didn't fall upon Joseph Barsabbas. And so while there is a strong argument could be made that Joseph Barsabbas in Acts chapter 1 is related to Judas Barsabbas in Acts chapter 15, there is little to absolutely no evidence elsewhere that would point or lead us to believe that this leader in the early church was the author of this letter. So we remove that as an option. Option number two would be maybe Judas the apostle. And so as to whether it was the apostle Jude, or also referred to as Thaddeus, whether or not he was the author of this letter, I think we can eliminate that as a possibility, especially by the time we get to verses 17 and 18, because the writer of this letter clearly did not view themselves on level or on par with the apostles. So, eliminating the early leader of the church and eliminating the apostle, then what do we have that's left? Well, I think the strongest argument and the most likely answer to the author of Jude is that Jude was a son of Mary and Joseph, which would also be a half-brother of Jesus. At first, I hope that you realize and recognize that at first in Jesus' ministry, I would even argue before his crucifixion and resurrection, Jesus' own family members did not believe in him. It tells us in scriptures in John chapter 7, verse number 5, it says, "For not even his brothers were believing in him." In fact, according to Mark chapter 3, verse number 21, when his own people heard of this, they went out to take custody of him, for they were saying, "He has lost his senses." So his brothers, his own family, thought that Jesus was out of his mind, not that his brothers did not recognize him as the one sent from God, the Son of God, to redeem mankind. In fact, it's not until the resurrection of Jesus that things begin to change. We read in scriptures in Acts chapter 1, verse number 14, it says that these all with one mind were continually devoting themselves to prayer along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. So now, by the time we get to Acts 1, we see that Jude is glad, is happy, and can rejoice to claim Jesus as not just his brother, but as his Savior and Lord. So Jude identifies himself in the beginning of this letter. He identifies himself by connecting himself with two other individuals. He says that he's the brother of James. And so the James that's being referred to here would also be a half-brother of Jesus. It's the author of the book of James. And so we know that these two are related and connected to each other because we can read about that relationship in Scripture. In fact, in Matthew chapter 13, Jesus was teaching in the synagogue, and he's teaching in the town of Nazareth. In Matthew chapter 13, verse number 55, people are amazed at his teaching, and they don't understand what's happening or how he has such divine knowledge and insight. And they say, "Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brothers Joseph and James and Simon and Judas?" And so here we know that the most likely explanation to the writer of this letter is that it is the half-brother of our Lord that pins the words that we're going to walk through. And so he identifies himself as a brother to James, but then he also, very beautifully, identifies himself as a bondservant to Jesus Christ. You think back into our study through the book of Romans, I hope that you'll realize and recognize this word, because this word bondservant comes from that Greek word doulos. And if you remember back, that word bondservant only means slave. The most accurate translation would be a slave of Jesus Christ. It is a term that's used to signify a relationship in which someone is under the complete authority and control of another being. And so Jude is saying, "I am a slave. I am under the authority, under the control of my own brother, Jesus." 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 20 tells us, "For you have been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body." In case you're ever wondering, well, what was the price that was paid in order to purchase those that believe in Christ? Well, Scripture's not silent on that price. In fact, in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 and 19, it informs us that You were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with precious blood, as of a lamb unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. How beautiful. The blood of Christ purchases our redemption. For those that submit and surrender themselves unto Christ, then Christ is our master. He is our Lord. We have placed ourselves under his rule, under his authority. In fact, we've given up on our own will, and we now take on the will of our master, so that all that we do in accordance to the plan and the purpose of the one who has purchased us, because we are not our own. Those that believe in Christ have been purchased by the blood of our Savior. We don't belong to ourselves. Therefore, we must live our lives in complete submission unto Him. So Jude embraced his brother as his king, as his Lord, as his master. Think about it. At first, he didn't believe that Jesus was the anointed one of God. But now he declares himself to be a slave of Jesus Christ. Now he believes that his brother is the Messiah. His brother is the anointed one. Now he believes that his brother is the Son of God who came to save mankind from their sin and from their destruction. He believed that it's only his brother that can save him from his sin, from his death, from the destruction that he deserves. He believes that his brother, Jesus, is the only one that can make him acceptable unto God. What an enormous turnaround. What an extremely encouraging testimony that we see in the life played out in Jude. And so we move from the author of this letter to the recipients. To whom is Jude writing? Well, he tells us, look at verse 1. So Jude, a bondservant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, then he says, to those who are the called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ. So the recipients are described or identified in three separate ways. First of all, they're called. Now, Jude's not using the word called as meaning like an invitation. No, here he's using the word call in connection to what we would refer to as the effectual call of God. It is the effectual call of God that opens the heart of an individual to freely respond to the gospel. I hope you realize, and maybe you don't, so I'll tell you just in case, that in the scriptures there are two calls that are referred to. There is an effectual call, and then there is a general call. In fact, the greatest passage that is known by the supermajority of individuals, whether they're believers or non-believers, is found in John 3:16. And there we see a beautiful picture of the general call of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but they have eternal life. So here we see God's general call to everyone in the world, which means that the gospel is available unto everyone, which means the gospel must be proclaimed to every person in every place. It is because of our sinful nature and because of our total depravity that no one will turn to God without first God impressing himself upon them. And so this is called the effectual call. The effectual call to a sinner so overwhelms a person's natural inclination to resist and rebel that they willingly place their faith, their trust, their confidence in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Scripture is not silent about this. Paul says in Philippians chapter 2, verse number 13. He says, "For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Jesus himself says in John chapter 6, probably the most clearest verse given to us about the effectual call of God, is John chapter 6, verse number 44. And there Jesus says that no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. No one can come to Christ without the effectual call of God happening in their lives. It's at this point that we can often get confused or frustrated. So let me try to be as clear as I possibly can. There is a mysterious wonder in the truth of God's sovereignty and God's sovereignly, effectively calling people unto himself. There is a mysterious wonder in the harmony of God's sovereignty and our human responsibility. In fact, God's sovereignty is in perfect harmony with individuals' ability to freely choose. In religious terms, we often tend to divide ourselves or identify ourselves with terms like Calvinism or Arminianism. We say things like, well, it's all about God's predestination versus, oh, it's all about the free will of man. Having spent nearly 2 calendar years walking through the book of Romans, we see the beautiful reality of the harmony between the two. We see that reality portrayed through the book of Romans. Think back. Romans chapter 9, we see God's sovereignty, how God is sovereign over our salvation. I mean, that's clear in Romans chapter 9. It's undeniable. Then you get to Romans chapter 10, and then you begin to see our responsibility towards God's sovereignty. In fact, Romans 10 tells us that if we confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. It's clear, right? But going back to Romans chapter 3, yeah, let's do that. Turn to Romans chapter 3. We'll pick up in verse number 10. As it is written, there is none righteous, not even one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become useless. There is none who does good. There's not even one. Their throat is an open grave. With their tongues they keep deceiving. The poison of asp is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their paths, and the path of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. It goes on to say that now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. Because by the work of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. For the law comes the knowledge of sin. And so may you know that on our own, like Romans chapter 3 paints a very horrific picture of humanity. That there's nothing good in us. There's no desire to do good in us. None of us on our own will seek after God. We just won't. It's our depravity that draws us into selfishness and self-centeredness. We want what we want. But unless God moves in their lives, and whether we believe it or not, we pray that believing,
Why is it that we pray for our unsaved loved ones or friends? We pray and we ask God to intervene in their lives, to show up, to make them aware of their great need for salvation. And so here's the beautiful thing. The effectual call of God is God moving in that person's life so that that person will, in harmony, freely choose to respond to the glorious gospel. So divine sovereignty, working in cooperation with human responsibility, is a marvelous and mind-bending mystery. If you were asked me, well, Pastor, are you a Calvinist or an Arminian? I would say yes. Do you believe in predestination or free will? I would say yes. You cannot speak to one and ignore the others. We're Western thinkers. This type of writing, this doesn't make sense to us because we want things to be linear. This isn't written in Western language. It's Eastern language, Eastern customs. And so they're not thrown off with the tension between the two. God's sovereignty and our responsibility to respond work in harmony with one another. And so Jude identifies his readers as first they are called. Then he identifies them as being beloved in God the Father. Oh, this is beautiful. I want you to understand that when he says that they're beloved, and then the third one, he's going to say that they're kept. Both of those terms are in the perfect tense. You might want to write that down because this is good. What does it mean for something to be in the perfect tense? It means that James is declaring that these are settled realities for the believer in Christ. So what's the first settled reality? Well, it's that they're beloved in God the Father. The emphasis is on how we are loved by the Father. This is the only place in the Bible that you're going to find the phrase beloved by God the Father. So there is a sense in which God loves all people indiscriminately, for God so loved the world, John 3:16. But there's also a sense in when God especially loves his children. May you understand that. I hope you can. Best way that I can compare that is to say, well, there is a sense where I love the church and the community in which we live in. But there's also a special, deeper sense of the love that I have for my wife and for my children. And so for those who are in Christ, God is now our Father, and He loves us with a perfect and permanent fatherly love. So he identifies his recipients as being called, as being loved, and then finally, they are kept for Jesus. Again, this word translated kept is in the perfect tense, which means that this is a settled position. I would argue that it would appear that this word kept is perhaps Jude's favorite word to use in this letter. We find it five times. We see it in verse number 1. We'll see it again in verse number 6, verse number 13, and verse number 21. And so that word means to protect, to keep from harm. It means to preserve. I want you to understand that this does not mean that as God's children, we are free from any difficulties or hardships in this life. That's not what this is saying. Rather, what this is saying is that the emphasis is placed upon the reality, the settled reality, that we are kept saved in our salvation. We're kept in our salvation by the work of Jesus Christ. I want you to look at this verse found in Hebrews chapter 7, verse number 25. It says, therefore, he is able also to save forever those who draw near to God through Him, talking about Christ, since He,
Christ, always lives to make intercession for them.
Why do I share that verse with you? Oh, I hope that you understand that by his work on earth, Jesus obtained my salvation. But it's by his work in heaven that Jesus maintains that salvation on my behalf. Left on my own, I'd lose it every day. But my salvation isn't dependent upon me. It's upon Christ, his work, his promise, the guarantee of the Holy Spirit deposited into our lives, of the inheritance that's to come. And so we have, he's writing to those that are called, loved in God the Father, kept for Jesus Christ. You're going to see as we walk through this letter that Jude loves to use triads, or groupings of three. In verse number one, the triad is that of being called, being loved, and being preserved. When we get to verse number two, we see another triad in place. And this is the beautiful blessing of three that talks about how we are abundantly blessed. And those that are called, those that are beloved, those that are kept for Christ, then he introduces the blessing that's reserved for them. Look at verse number two. He says, may mercy and peace and love be multiplied to you. And we just briefly consider the significance of these three blessings. First of all, he says mercy. Mercy is God not giving us what we rightly deserve. Because of our sin, every single one of us deserve God's condemnation. But God in his mercy does not give us what we deserve. Instead, for those that believe in his Son, God gave our punishment to Jesus, and Jesus took on that punishment at the cross. Then if we will truly repent and believe, then we receive God's beautiful gift of mercy and grace. So he says mercy. I mean mercy. And then he says in peace. Peace simply could be defined as the end of hostility with God. The end of hostility with God. Whereas we were once his enemies, now through faith in his Son, we are now adopted into his family. It is only because of Christ that we can experience and enjoy peace with God. The unsaved individual, or your pre-salvific self, if you will, you were an enemy of God. You were at war with God, whether you realized it or not, because of your spiritual condition. Because of the darkness and the depravity of our human nature, we were at enmity with God. We were at war with God. But once someone puts their faith and trust in the Savior, oh, good news, the war ends. Now we're at peace with the Father. We're to walk in that peace, walk in that fellowship. And not only now because we're at peace with the Father, we can have a better understanding on how we're to walk at peace with one another. But we'll never truly experience peace with individuals without first and foremost having peace with God. Scripture tells us in Romans chapter 5, verse number 1, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. He is the only way to experience peace. So we have this mercy. We have peace, and then there's love. Love is way much more than a feeling, biblically speaking. Love is a commitment of the will. And it's a commitment of the will that seeks the ultimate good of another. We're familiar with it. Love is beautifully portrayed in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And so, the cross is God's demonstration of his perfect love for mankind. That's what Scripture tells us. Romans chapter 5, verse number 8. But God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God demonstrated his love through the death of his son. The perfect demonstration of perfect love. The question becomes, have you received that love into your life? Have you received that gift that God has given to mankind? Have you submitted your life to the Savior? Do you recognize that on your own you have no hope of heaven? On your own, your future reality is eternal condemnation. But through Christ, who took on our punishment at Calvary, if we will repent, believe, confess him as Lord, we confess him as Lord, as master, of ruler of our lives. We believe that God raised him from the dead. And then the beautiful reality is that if you'll do that, then you'll receive his mercy, his peace, and his love. One final thought. I especially enjoy the fact that Jude desired that mercy, peace, and love, that it would be multiplied unto them. Not added to it, but multiplied in and among their lives. Jude longed for his readers to know and to experience the full measure of God's mercy, peace, and love. And my desire, my prayer, is that the time that we spend walking through this book, that it would help us to experience in abundance the mercy, the peace, and the love of God. So may we know God's mercy more intimately. May we know his peace more completely. And may we know and experience his love more firmly. May we know all of this and abundantly so much more. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for your great love unto us. Father, I recognize that not everybody that is among us has received that gift into their lives. So, Father, I pray, if it be in accordance to your will, Father, that your Spirit would carry out that effectual call in our lives, that we would submit and surrender all that we have and all that we are unto you. And for your children that are gathered in this place or watching or listening online, whatever or wherever they are, God, I pray that you would give us great clarity as to who we are and what we're doing in this life. May we understand that our purpose is to glorify you and to make your glory known. But God, forgive us in the ways that we fail. Forgive us for the sin that we eagerly run back to time and time again. God, help us to be determined this year to make a change, to grow, to love your word, to read your word, to memorize your word, to consistently pray for one another, and to serve in a capacity that honors the spiritual gift in which that you have given us. But God, in this time of reflection and this opportunity to respond to your word, Father, I pray that you would be pleased. Help us, Father. Help us. In Christ's name I pray.